Hello everyone. Today, we'll be starting topic 2.2. Specifically, we'll be looking at the differences between light and electron microscopes, then looking at the structure and reproduction of prokaryotes, like this bacteria right here. Now, with that said, let's dive right in. The first thing you need to know is that electron microscopes have a much higher resolution than light microscopes. So, a few things. First off, what is an electron microscope? What is a light microscope? Light microscopes very simply use light. They use a light bulb to view things, and it's basically a giant magnifying glass. Literally, these are the ones we use in the classroom, where you can use your eyes to see things directly. Meanwhile, electron microscopes do not use light. They use electrons, which have a much smaller wavelength than light, so they allow you to see much smaller things. Now, electron microscopes have a much higher resolution than light microscopes. But what does resolution actually mean when we talk about the resolution of your computer screen or the resolution of your phone? What does that mean? Now, technically, the definition of resolution is the smallest distance where you can tell two points apart. So if I look at these three images, this one has the worst resolution, because the smallest distance you can tell two things apart is here. Meanwhile, this one has a better resolution, because you can tell more points apart. And this one has the best of these images. Basically, think of resolution as pixels. The lower your resolution, the bigger your pixels. That means that your image is grainier. It's harder to tell two points apart. The smaller your pixels, the better the resolution. The easier it is to tell two things which are right next to each other apart. Now, light microscopes, their pixels is about 400 to 700 nanometers. So a pixel in a light microscope is about 500 nanometers. That's about the size of a pixel. Now this translates to about 1,000 times magnification. Meanwhile, an electron microscope has a pixel of 0.01. nanometers. So, which one has the smaller pixel? Light microscopes or electron microscopes? Now, quite obviously, electron microscopes have much smaller pixels. The difference is really like going from here to here in terms of the quality of the image. So here, for light microscopes, you have to be very zoomed out to see anything. They can go up to 1,000 times magnification. Meanwhile, electron microscopes can go to 10 million times magnification. Let's look at some examples of what this means in practice. With a 1,000 times magnification, resolution of about half a micrometer, or 500 nanometers, you get images like this. So here's a light microscope, and here's a cell under the light microscope. What type of cell is this? It's a plant cell. You can tell because of its rectangular shape and these green chloroplasts inside it. Now, if I were to look at the same plant cell under a light microscope, an electron microscope, with a 10 million times magnification and a resolution of about 0.01 nanometers, these green little things inside the plants would look like this. This is one chloroplast. And not only can you see a lot more detail, you can actually see inside it. You can see the vertical lines and these dots inside it. The dots are ribosomes, by the way. Now, note that you do not need to memorize the resolutions. You do not need to know the resolution of a light microscope and an electron microscope. You just need to know that electron microscopes have a higher resolution. So, light microscopes, lower resolution, electron microscopes, I can actually zoom in to a chloroplast and see this. You can zoom in even more. This is actually an electron micrograph of a DNA molecule. So here you can actually see the rungs of DNA. Now, an electron microscope looks a little like this. They're very big machines, and they actually have a huge air pump. The problem with electron microscopes is they have such a high resolution that they can see air molecules. Air molecules get in the way. So to use an electron microscope, you have to suck all the air out of the microscope. Now, if you do that, you kill whatever you're looking at. Also, because there's no light in there, you only get black and white images. So light microscopes allow you to see colored images of living cells, while electron microscopes give you black and white images of dead cells, but at a much higher resolution. That's why scientists still use both of them. They have their advantages and disadvantages. Now again, for the IB, you really only need to know that electron microscopes have a higher resolution than light microscopes. This allows us to see a lot more details within the cell. However, light microscopes allow us to see color in living samples. Now, everything you need to know is on this slide. This is what you need to take notes on. Now, a little bit extra, what resolution is the human eye? And here we can see the human eye goes down to about 10 to the minus 4 meters. That's about a tenth of a millimeter. Light microscopes go down to about half a micrometer. So half of a thousandth of a millimeter. Now, electron microscopes can even see atoms. That's crazy. It allows us to make images like these, where you can actually see the real atomic structure. Now, it's dead, it's black and white, but the resolution is crazy. Here you see graphene, and obviously the color is added. And here, magnesium dibromide, and you can actually see the atoms. And that's really, really incredible. Now, people sometimes have fun with this, proving their technology by moving individual atoms to spell out words. IBM, which makes computers, famous for Watson, their processing program, always likes to prove their technology by doing things like this. And most recently, they actually used an electron microscope to make a movie, a stop-motion movie using atoms. It's called A Boy and His Atom, and let's quickly watch. So, a truly incredible movie. These waves you see are actually caused by the electronic charges of the individual atoms. So anyway, that's resolution. Let's actually move into prokaryote structure now. So, you have to know that prokaryotes have a simple structure with no compartments, so there's no membranes inside a prokaryote. And you need to know how to draw and label them, based on electron micrograph. Now wait a second, maybe you're thinking, what is a prokaryote? Well, let's look at the giant domains of life. Here are bacteria, archaea, and then eukaryotes. And here are animals, fungi, plants. All of the things that we consider living things are in the eukaryote. Most species are actually bacteria or archaea. These are prokaryotes. When I say prokaryote, I'm really talking about bacteria. Now, technically, not all prokaryotes are bacteria, but all bacteria are prokaryotes. And when I ask you to draw and label a prokaryote, I'm asking you to draw and label a bacteria. Now, what does a bacteria look like? Here we go. Bacteria have this green cell membrane, which is the actual limits of the bacteria. Outside of this green layer, they have a hard cell wall, which is technically outside the bacteria, and it protects them from harm. They sometimes have this red capsule, which you don't have to draw, the IV won't give you points for drawing it. But this red capsule is actually slimy and lets them swim and squish through things. Inside their green cell membrane, there's a blue cytoplasm, the liquid that fills the cell. There's their DNA, this red nucleoid region, and also small little plasmids, loops of extra DNA that they can carry around. Their green cell membranes can push out into the things called pili, which allow them to hold on to things or communicate with other bacteria. And they also have these little balls, ribosomes, which make their proteins. Finally, sticking out the back, there is a flagellum. The flagellum is how they swim. It's used for motion. So let's dive into these one at a time. The cell wall is on the outside of the bacteria. It's always present. And two big things, you have to know these two that I've just highlighted. It provides physical protection and helps the cell keep its shape. Now, these are made of peptidoglycan. You don't need to know that word. And it also helps them from bursting if there's too much water around them. But really, the main purpose is providing protection and keeping their shape. Then, there's the plasma membrane. The plasma membrane is a thin layer right inside the cell wall. Now, this layer actually makes the cell wall. It excretes the cell wall on top of it, which is why this plasma membrane is actually the limits of the bacteria. The cell wall is outside. Now, this cell membrane, or plasma membrane, provides a barrier for homeostasis. It only allows good things in, like oxygen or food, and it allows wastes out, like carbon dioxide. Now, it can pump substances in by active transport, it can do diffusion to allow things in or out, it can even make ATP for cell respiration. That's the cell membrane. And here, this is an electron micrograph made with electron microscope. And the black line on the inside is the cell membrane. That outer black line is the cell wall. That's what you should think of them as, actually. Though technically the cell wall is thicker. It's the whole white space as well. And this is a zoomed-in version of the plasma membrane. Don't worry about it yet. We will actually study and you'll have to know how to draw and label that eventually. Now, the plasma membrane can actually pinch out through the cell wall in shapes called pili. Now, one pilus, two pili, just like one octopus, two octopi, that's English. And these pili are actually filaments extruding through the cell wall made of the cell membrane. And they're used for holding on to things, adhesion, and they're also used for exchanging DNA. So here we can see two bacteria doing that, where this long pili is connecting the two of them. And here's another colored picture, where you can see these red pili sticking out, and that these bacteria are using them to hold on to each other. Either cell-to-cell adhesion, holding on to each other, or what's called conjugation, exchanging DNA. It's basically bacteria sex. So let's actually see a little bit of this.
We're going to have two bacteria, one here. This is resistant. Here's our antibiotic-resistant gene. It's going to then make something called a pilus and transfer the gene over. Boom, it encodes this thing. Now we have an antibiotic-resistant gene in here, and this organism now has the resistance to the antibiotics. Again and again, bacteria do this. Again and again, we see this happening in our bodies.
Okay. Now, onto the flagella. One flagellum, two flagella. This is a structure that sticks out of the cell wall. It's actually anchored in the cell wall, and you have to draw it as such. And it uses membrane energy to spin. And this actually spins like a propeller. It's solid, it's hard, and as it spins, the bacteria can move. That's the flagella. And they can be several times longer than the bacteria. And here you see the pili around the bacteria. The liquid filling the cell membrane is the cytoplasm, and it's basically water with stuff dissolved in it. Now, the cytoplasm contains all the enzymes needed for the bacteria's metabolism. It has all the ribosomes to make all the proteins, and I've underlined this. You have to know there are no membranes inside a prokaryote cell membrane. All of the chemical reactions of metabolism happen right in the cytoplasm, if you're a bacteria. Now, one of the other things inside the cytoplasm is something called a plasmid, which is a small loop of DNA. These can be traded with other prokaryotes using pili, and here you can see a zoomed-in version from an electron micrograph. And here again, another video of them trading.
First step in plasmid transfer is contact between the donor and the recipient. The F pilus of the donor cell recognizes and binds to specific receptor sites on the cell wall of the recipient cell. The plasmid then becomes mobilized for transfer. A single strand of the F plasmid, beginning at the origin of transfer, enters the F minus cell. A complementary strand to the single-stranded plasmid remaining in the donor is synthesized via the rolling circle mechanism. Once inside the recipient cell, a complementary strand to the single-stranded DNA is synthesized. When F plus and F minus cells are mixed together, eventually all of the cells become F plus.
Next. Inside the cell membrane, we have ribosomes. Ribosomes make proteins. You have to know that. Ribosomes make proteins. They are the sites of protein synthesis. Now, they are small structures that kind of look like grains, and you have to know that their size is 70S. S is a unit, like centimeter. It's an old one, but you also have to know eukaryotes, which we'll get to later, have 80S ribosomes. So, prokaryotes have 70S ribosomes, and they're just these little grains. This is a highly zoomed in image. Now, to increase the surface area of the cell membrane, there are mesosomes, which are in curlings. They curl in from the cell membrane. Almost finally, we're down to, well, in fact, I think finally, we're down to the nucleoid. This is the actual genetic material, usually a single molecule of DNA, that's inside the prokaryote. And we'll talk about this later, in fact, higher levels, we'll talk about it in detail next year, how DNA in a prokaryote is naked. That means it's not associated with any proteins. So it's normally one loop of DNA, and it's not associated with proteins. In eukaryotes, the DNA is normally coiled around, just like string, to keep it organized. Now, the nucleoid is usually lighter in a micrograph. So, here we can see it in a micrograph image. There it is. So, this is a prokaryote under the microscope. And you can see the scale bar right here, 0.1 micrometers, or micrometers. So, here we have the labels, a drawn image, which you should be able to draw, and an electrograph, which you should be able to label. So, last thing to go over, prokaryote reproduction. How do they reproduce? Now, bacteria, prokaryotes, reproduce by binary fission. Now, here we can actually see them reproducing by binary fission. Actually, one just breaks into two. To do this, the cell has to grow and copy its DNA, that way you have two copies that can then be separated. And the cell wall will then pinch in, separating the two copies of DNA, eventually dividing the two cells. So, here are some of my favorite videos to show on this. The video of binary fission. So let's go through these two.
Some living things remain a single cell throughout their lives. For example, these are E. coli bacteria. Millions of these microscopic creatures inhabit our intestines. Bacteria are very simple creatures. Unlike most cells, a bacterium doesn't even have a nucleus. But when it comes to reproducing, bacteria are marvels of efficiency. When a bacterium reproduces, it pinches in the middle, and then the cell divides in two. Each of the two new cells is exactly like the original one. Bacteria can reproduce very rapidly. Some types divide once every 20 minutes. At this rate, a single bacterium can become over a billion bacteria in less than 12 hours. This kind of reproduction is called asexual reproduction, because only one parent is needed to reproduce.
Now again, the steps involve the cell growing, the plasma membrane and cell wall splitting in, the two copies of DNA being separated, and finally, the cells separating. So again, let's watch a few more videos on this.
Almost all bacteria cells reproduce by binary fission. As the term suggests, this is a process by which a single cell simply splits in two, creating two identical copies of itself. The first step in this process is replication. At the replication stage, the bacteria increases in size and makes an exact duplicate of its chromosome. Following this, the bacterium begins to elongate and pinch off in the center. The two chromosomes move to opposing sides of the cell, and the cell wall grows to fill in the pinched gap in the center. This results in two separate, yet identical cells that are an exact match of the original parent cell.
Bacteria reproduce very simply and rapidly by doubling their contents and splitting in two. Just one bacterium, dividing every 20 minutes, could produce nearly 5,000 billion billion bacteria in one day.
Okay, we're done. That was the difference between light and electron microscopes, prokaryote structure, and prokaryote reproduction.